My name is Colin Carter. I'm director of the Giannini Foundation of Agricultural Economics. I'd like to thank Julie McNamara for helping me organize this big event for our campus. The Giannini Foundation was established in the 1920s by A.P. Giannini, who also founded the Bank of America. He was a true visionary. He believed in agriculture, and he gave a very significant gift to the University of California to study the economics of agriculture. So it's very appropriate we have with us for our 2010 Giannini lecture, Dr. Justin Lin, who's the chief economist at the World Bank. Dr. Lin is one of the most influential economists in the world. Before he came to the bank, he was twice judged the most influential economist in China. So it's quite a pleasure to have him here, and we can thank Mr. Giannini for his foresight, because we're seeing the benefits today with Justin's visit and taking time to speak with our graduate students. And also his wife, Dr. Chen, is here, so it's a pleasure to have them. And I think given the mission of the foundation is to study the economics of agriculture, it's particularly appropriate to have the chief economist from the World Bank, because ever since Robert McNamara was president of the bank in the 1970s, this has been a major focus at the World Bank, is the alleviation of poverty. And I give you Dr. Lin, and we look forward to your lecture, Justin.
Well, thank you very much for this introduction. And it's a great honor for me to give this annual Giannini lecture. But I accept this invitation with great pleasure. And I say, it's a great pleasure for me to come to give this lecture for four reasons. The first one, I started my career as an agricultural economist. And when I was training in Chicago and so on, I heard a lot about the agricultural economic research at UC Davis. And this is one of the best centers on agricultural economics in the States, also in the world. And for someone working on agriculture economics, I really hope I had the opportunity to come here to visit, to exchange ideas, learnings from faculty members and students here. And your invitation, fulfill my dream. The second reason to visit this campus and to give this lecture is a great pleasure for me. It's because of I returned to China in 1987, and I established the China Center for Economic Research together with my colleagues, Professor Wen Hai, and we worked together to build the centers from scratch to become one of the most influential policy and educational institutions in China. And Wen Hai received his training from UC Davis. So UC Davis made a very important contribution to my own career, certainly, also to the education in China. And I'd like to report, Professor Wen Hai now, he is the vice president of Peking University. And so certainly, I need to come here to say, to express my gratitude to the UC Davis for the help I received from your students in China. And the third reason, I think it's a great pleasure for me because of the topic. I work in the World Bank. And the mission of the World Bank is a world free of poverty. And we know that most poor people live on agriculture. And how to help them, I need to count on your knowledge and contribution. And to give a talk on how to increase the resilience of the poor people to the financial crisis, wealth crisis, and so on. I'm sure I can learn a lot from you. And the last one, but not the least one, to my mind, no matter what kind of job I do, I'm a professor. And talking to colleagues and to students is always the most enjoyable things that I like to do. And this lecture gave me this opportunity to meet with students again. So I cannot resist this temptation to come to give this lecture. But certainly, the topic is how to make the poor more resilient to overcome future crises. For good luck or bad luck, I joined the World Bank in June 2008, about 2 years ago. And when I joined the World Bank, at that time, the most challenging task for me is how to help the poor people to cope with the food and the fuel crisis at that time. And according to our estimation, about 135 million people to about 150 million people lost the opportunity to get out of poverty because of that crisis. But very soon, immediately 3 months later, the international global financial crisis erupted. And it was so scary because when it first erupted, you saw the impact on the collapse of equity market, international trade, and industrial production in almost all the countries in the world. They were more serious than what happened in 1929. And how to cope with that kind of challenges certainly is a big issue to someone like me at the World Bank, because we expect that are going to have a huge impact on poverty. But luckily, we learn lessons from the past. The major country's government immediately implement the financial rescue plan to stabilize the banking sectors. And I think that's very important, that avoided the worst possible scenario. At the same time, all the major countries in the G20 and so on pledged to continue follow the principle of free trade. And that, again, is another reason we avoid the worst scenario. In addition to that, all the major countries' government immediately adopted monetary policy to ease the credit. At the same time, fiscal policies to stimulate domestic demand and so on. And plus now, the restocking of inventory. We started to see the recovery. In the emerging market, in the second quarter of 2009, and in the high-income country, in the second half, third quarters or fourth quarters of last year. And now, according to the statistics, we know that although the global economy was contracted in 2009, but overall, the developing country, on the average, their growth rate is still positive, 1.2%. And looking forward, the recovery has been stronger than we expected at the beginning. And likely, according to our forecast, this year in a high-income country, their growth rate is likely to increase from negative 2.1 up to positive 2.2 in 2010. And in the low-income country, in a developing country, their growth rate in 2010 is likely to increase to 6% from 1.2% in 2009. But I'd like to say, in spite of the recovery and likely to be positive growth rate in both high-income country and a developing country, according to our estimation, by the end of this year, again, 64 million people will lose the opportunity to get out of poverty. And looking forward, although we already have a recovery, But the foundation for the recovery is still very fragile. Employment, high, you know, unemployment in many parts of the world will maintain a high level. And excess capacity will still be huge in the high-income country and many developing countries. So under this kind of scenario, certainly we need to learn some lesson from this food crisis, economic crisis. And to help the poor people in the future to weather through this kind of crisis better. Because even with such a shock in the food, fuel, and economic crisis, we see some countries are doing better than the other country. And just like Paul Krugman once said, a crisis is an opportunity that not to be wasted. So I hope we can learn some lessons. And so my talk about deal with two issues. One is a food and a fuel crisis, especially in the food crisis. And the other one is economic crisis. We know the crisis, no matter it's a food, fuel, or economic crisis, the poor are always the most vulnerable. If the food crisis increase, some of them will not have the ability to buy the food to feed themselves and their children. So under that kind of situation, you know, you're going to have something Amartya Sen called the entitlement crisis. Some of them may become starvation, or some area even has some kind of issue of famine. And for the economic crisis, again, unemployment rate will be increasing. People will lose their job. And if people lose their job, they will lose the means to support themselves and their children. And no matter it's a food crisis or economic crisis, the impact is not only immediate. The impact can be longer because we know if you do not have enough nutrition at a certain age, then you will be stunned and you will lose ability in the future. And again, if you have economic crisis and your family cannot support you for the schooling education, again, you will lose your opportunity in the future to benefit or to make a contribution to economic growth. So under this kind of, you know, situation, I think to discuss the topic, it's important, and it's important to the mission of the World Bank. For the food crisis, how come it happened from time to time and from area to areas? And we want to, you know, avoid the food crisis or to improve the resilience of the poor people to cope with the food crisis. We need to understand the nature of the crisis. I think for the food crisis, two most important natures that we need to consider is that food is something, it's elastic of demand and supply is very small. And the second, food is a market, it's extremely thin, especially in the international market. And another observation regarding the food crisis related to these two natures. Because food is inelastic in the demand, you need to have certain nutrition to survive. And under this kind of situation, if there are small reduction in the production, sometimes the price can increase dramatically. And as I say, when the price increases too much, the poor people, especially the poor people in urban areas, they will not have the means to buy enough for themselves and their children. So under this kind of situation, if the government wants to help, one very important way is to reduce the variation in the production. And we know that food production, grain production, very much depends on the weather because it's a biological process. And the shock in the weather, in the water supply, in the sunlight availability and so on, can reduce the food production. So under that kind of situation, if the government wants to reduce the variation, especially in the reduction of the grain output. The other way, one certainly, is to introduce better variety of the grain, drought resistant, cold resistant, and so on, or pest resistant. And for that, new technology that innovated in research center like UC Davis can help a lot. And the government certainly also need to have a national agricultural research system, extension system, to make those kind of technology available to farmers. But in addition to the technology, because agricultural production rely on waters, and waters, how to make that water become available without depend on the rainfall. Irrigation is also very important. At the same time, new technology often also require the water availability. So they have some kind of mutual reinforcement. If you have a better irrigation, it's better to apply better technology. And if you have a better technology, you require more reliable water supply. This is one area the government can help. But I like to say, this kind of technology infrastructure not only can reduce the variation in the agricultural production, it is also a very important way to increase the income of the farmer. If farmers' income increase, even their own production reduce, they will have the means to buy from the market. And that will also increase the resilience of the poor people. If they can have a high income, certainly at that time, you may not call them poor people, but fundamentally, what we want is to help them no matter how we label them. But certainly, because agricultural production is a biological process, no matter how better the technology, what infrastructure you have, some kind of variation in the production is unavoidable. And under that kind of situation, the way for the government to help is in two directions. One is to keep certain national reserve. So if you have some location because of weather or some unexpected event, the production reduced. And because it's inelastic, the price can increase a lot. And if the government keeps some kind of national reserve and release the reserve, the price can be stabilized. And under the current situation, the shock to the poor will be much smaller. And the other way is that to have a better social protection program. So if price increase to some extent, and the government can have a target social protection, allow those people have enough means to acquire enough food for themselves and their children, that will further, you know, help the poor people. And in this few dimensions, the World Bank can help. The World Bank is a knowledge bank. At the same time, the World Bank is also a lending institution. So for that, the World Bank can promote new technologies by its lending program or the support to international agricultural research institution or national agricultural research and extension institution. And one very important institution is the CGIAR, Consultative Group of International Agricultural Research. And the World Bank is a main funding institution to support that international organization. The World Bank can also use its fund to support irrigation or to support building up reserve in the developing country. And the World Bank can also, you know, use fund and knowledge to help the developing country building up its social safety net. And this related to the issue I call the inelastic part of the food crisis. The other one related to the same market. The same market is a very important country with different competitive advantages. Like many developing countries, they have a very high population density, and agrable land is very limited. In a high-income country like the U.S., you have abundant land, and so you have comparative advantage in grain production. You know, when I drove from the airport to here, and Colin told me, you see such a beautiful rice field there, and you export rice, right? And I like to say, certainly for the country development, they should rely on their comparative advantages. And if they don't have comparative advantage in grain production, they should produce this grain. And country like the U.S. has comparative advantage in producing grain, you should produce more and sell to the international market. And that should be a win-win situation where will improve for both importing country and exporting country. However, I think for us agricultural economists, we know the global grain market is extremely thin. And under this kind of situation, supposedly there are some kind of weather variation in some part of the world, and their grain production reduced. And to meet this kind of inelastic demand, they need to import some grain from international market. Because international market is so thin, the price in international market will increase a lot. And under that kind of situation, some exporting country, they want to protect their domestic consumer. They may start to introduce some kind of export embargo. And that is going to further push the global prices to go up. And that is going to be extremely harmful for the importing country. Because when your grain import price is so high, it will also, you know, hurt their consumption. But more importantly, it's that information will transmit. Farmers, no matter it's in a producing country or the importing country, seeing the price increase so much, it's very easy to trigger them to have some kind of herd holding behavior. They do not want to share. They expect the price to go even up so they can get more in the futures. And that will further push the price up. And that is one of the reasons why in 2007 and 2008, we see the international price within just a few months, you know, doubled and tripled. And the grain production actually did not reduce so much during that time. That's one. In addition, this kind of, you know, national interest, some country want to protect themselves and introduce embargo. The other complicating factor is speculation, especially when you have excess liquidity in a financial system. And under the kind of situation, the speculators often treat grain as another category of asset. And then when they observe some country reduce their production due to the thin international market, they expect international price is going to go up. They started to hold in, they start to speculate, push the prices. And when price increases, you're going to have those kind of self-reinforcing prophecy. Price will increase even further. And that is related to the thin market. So under this kind of situation, how to cope with that? From each individual nations, there are several options. One is to rely on the self-sufficiency in grain. And that is a policy some country are considering now. But as economists, we know, if we go into the self-sufficiency in grain, it's going to be very, very inefficient. Everyone is going to lose. And under that kind of situation, what can we do? I think there are several areas we can work together. One is to support free trade, to argue for free trade. The government should not treat trade as a way to protect themselves at the cost of the others. And it's very often, even you want to protect yourself by grain embargo, but the information in international market will transmit back to your home country, and your farmer is going to have a holding, and even that, the domestic price will also increase. So to have a free trade is the best principle. And I think that in this international financial crisis, in G20, all the leaders praise free trade. That is a very important contributing factor that we can have such an early recovery. And I think in grain market, that should be the same principle. So we should advocate free trade. And the second one is to have some kind of global arrangement. To have two ways. One is to have a shared international grain reserve. Because you know, the way the impact in general is in one location, in one country. You know, it will not be in every country. We haven't reached that stage yet. You know, global climate change may reach that stage. But so far, most of this kind of weather impact is localized. And an individual country's grain reserve may not be enough to stabilize its domestic prices. But if we can have some kind of globally shared reserve, and a finance institution and a policy regarding how to release the grain to prevent the price hike in the international market, we can cut down the channel for those kind of vicious cycle. And the other one is how to cope with the likely speculators. And that is one possibility, so-called virtual stock. We have an international institution with certain amount of fund, and you see the price increase to some extent, you in a spot market, and you can share the future contract at a low price and bring down the prices and stop the possible speculation. These are all possible channels that we can help to make the grain market, grain prices, you know, less volatile and make a poor will have less shock. And with this, the World Bank can also help. It's one of the most important international development agencies, and we can be a voice for free trade. Certainly, you can also be a voice for free trade. We also can engage in a study, and you can also engage in a study about the international share reserve, about the design and implementation of the virtual stock. And for the World Bank, we can also be an institution to come up with some kind of global food crisis response trust fund program. And for that, in the 2008-2009 food crisis, we introduced some of those programs and find, you know, have proved to be very helpful. And in the G20 meeting, the World Bank is mandated to take those kind of initiative to come up with some trust fund and to help the poor country in the future. This is something I'd like to say regarding the food crisis. The other one is economic crisis, the financial crisis. In the past, we often thought economic crisis is only some phenomena occur in the poor country. But this time we found that global crisis can originate in the rich part of the world. And when it originated in the rich part of the world, the developing country cannot avoid from the shock. And under the kind of situation, as I say, when you have a crisis, unemployment will increase. Poor people will lose job, and many of them will not have the means to, you know, support themselves and their family. And what is the way to cope with this kind of global crisis or to reduce the possibilities of domestic crisis? As I mentioned, in this crisis, some countries are doing better than the other country, like China, India, or those, you know, BRIC country, emerging market. But some other developing countries need to have a large shock, especially in the Eastern European country, Latin American country, and in some African country. For that, I'd like to say, the best way to protect the poor is to provide jobs to the poor, to hire growth, and to make the economy competitive. and to strengthen the government fiscal position and the external position. And by that, they can reduce domestic homegrown crisis. Even they have external crisis, the room for the government to adopt counter-cyclical measure will be larger. And so they can help building some kind of buffer zone and reduce the shock to their poor people. But how to do that? That's what we observe, but how to do that? I think the way that the issue, you know, in my mind for a long time, and my recommendation is that a country, in each stage of their development, if they follow their competitive advantages in choosing their sectors and in adopting their technologies, then under this kind of situation, the country will grow fastest, will create more jobs. Their government will have a better fiscal position and will have a better external outcome. And how come I think a simple principle that we observe from international trade can have this kind of miraculous result? The reason is that, certainly, if you want to achieve that, the national economy needs to be very competitive, right? And we know there's a new term created by a professor at Harvard called competitive advantages. And so if a country wants to be competitive, you need to achieve competitive advantages. But how to achieve competitive advantages? According to the Michael Porter, the promoter of this new theory, he said that if a country wanted to have competitive advantage in this globalized system, four principles. The first one, the country needs to go into sectors, develop the sectors, which can use their abundant factors. If you have abundant factor in labor, you should develop more labor, abundant labor intensive sectors. If you are abundant in capital, you develop capital intensive sectors. That's one thing. The second one, you should go to the sectors which you have a larger domestic product, a market for those products. And the third one is that in the industry, the sector you want to go into, you should have large cluster in your domestic economy. So it's not a single firm. You have other firm in that sector. And the last principle, this sector in the domestic economy should be competitive. They should not be monopoly. Okay, these four principles seem to be very comprehensive. But if we think carefully, actually the first principle, going to sector, use your abundant factors, not just follow your competitive advantage, right? From the international trade theory. If you're a labor abundant country, certainly you develop labor intensive industry and vice versa. And I like to say, the third principle cluster, the fourth principle, domestic competition, a consequence of following your competitive advantages. Like in the US, can you have a lot of large cluster in garment industry or textile industry in the US? No, because they are labor intensive industries. And you do not have competitive advantage in labor. And so you cannot have a lot of firm enter into garment or textile industries. And since you do not have firm who are willing to go into those kind of sectors, you cannot have a cluster. So cluster is a consequence, it's an endogenous phenomenon of following your competitive advantages. Like you go to China, you can see a lot of textile industry. And you know, they have a lot of cluster. And last one, competition. If you want to establish a sector which go against your competitive advantages, they are not viable unless they are protected by the government. Otherwise, they cannot be there. And if they are protected by the government, how can they have a domestic competition? So I would say, you know, the four principles of competitive advantages can be boiled down to the two principles. The first one is to follow your competitive advantages. The second one is going to a sector which have a domestic market. But again, we know, once you follow your competitive advantages, you can have a whole global market. The large domestic market become not important. And that's the reason why small country like Finland, only with 5 million population, but they can have a Nokia, right? And in Sweden, they can have Ericsson. And in Switzerland, they can have so many products that conquer the whole world, right? So by that, I say that if you wanted to be competitive in an international system, you need to follow your competitive advantage. And for a low-income country, I think all of them, abundant labor is their abundant factor, right? And so if you follow in a low-income country, you follow their competitive advantages, they must develop labor-intensive sectors, adopt labor-intensive technologies. Under that kind of situation, they can create a lot of jobs. And we know poor people, the only asset they can earn their livings is their labor force. And if we create a lot of jobs for them, they can become wage earners. They can benefit themselves from the process of economic development. And also, as I say, if you follow your competitive advantages, you will be competitive. Under that kind of situation, you will have less homegrown crisis. And since you are competitive, you grow very fast. The government's revenue will increase, right? The government fiscal position will be in a much better shape. And since you are competitive, your external account should be quite good. So under that kind of situation, even they have some kind of external shock, the government will have the ability to adopt fiscal stimulus and so on, and to maintain the reasonable rate of growth. And so under that kind of situation, certainly the economy will weather through the crisis much better. And just to contrast, if the government, if the country do not follow their competitive advantage, what will be the result? They are going to establish sectors which are not competitive internationally. And the firm in those kind of sectors are not going to be viable. And the establishment and the continued operation of those kind of firms rely on government's continuous protection and subsidies. Otherwise, they cannot be there. And the government's protection and subsidies always are in the form of all kind of distortions. And those kind of subsidies and protection will create a rent. So you are going to see have a rent seeking, corruption. And only a small number of firms can enter into those kind of sectors. And it's very easy to become some kind of political capture for those kind of rent. So they are going to be very inefficient. And under this kind of situation, although they may be able to establish certain industry which look very handsome, but they are not going to create jobs. The poor people will be excluded. At the same time, because they are not competitive, if they have some kind of external shock, they are going to have some, very often they are going to have internal crisis. And especially when there is some external shock, the government wouldn't have the means to have this counter-cyclical measure. So poor will be the most vulnerable. And so from this understanding, if we want to avoid the shock of the crisis, or to reduce the possibility of shock of the crisis, the most important is for the country to follow their competitive advantage in the development. But unfortunately, competitive advantage is a term only you and me as economists understand. For the entrepreneur, they do not care about competitive advantage or not. They only care about profit. And so how to translate this kind of theoretical understanding into an operation, incentive and compatible operation for the firm? I think the most important is that you need to have the price system which can reflect the relative abundance of your factors. When you are abundant in labor force, wage rate should be relatively low, capital should be relatively expensive. And when you become more abundant in capital, then capital should be relatively inexpensive, wage should be relatively expensive. And how to get those kind of price system? The only way we know so far is competitive market. So if a country wanted to follow their competitive advantage in the development, they need to establish a good competitive market system. But I think market alone may not be enough, because if you follow your competitive advantages, you will be so competitive, you will accumulate your capital so fast, and your competitive advantage will change. You need to upgrade your industry, you need to diversify your industries. And in this industrial upgrading and diversification process, there are many coordination issues, externality issues. So we also need to have a government which can play some kind of facilitating role to help the country to have a smooth transition in its industrial upgrading and industrial diversification. And for this, as I say, the government, on the one hand, need to improve the function of the market. On the other hand, need to play those kind of facilitating role, overcome coordination issue and externality issue. And for the World Bank, what can we do? Well, I think for the World Bank, there are several areas. First one, World Bank is not only a bank. World Bank is a knowledge bank. And for the knowledge bank, it's very important for us to provide right development knowledge. I think in the past, in the development thinking, we seen from in the 1950s and 60s to emphasize the role of the government, market failures, and to promote the import substitution strategy and most strategy are in sectors which go against their competitive advantages. So it failed very poorly. In the 1980s, we started to promote liberalization and focus on the government failures. And as a result, again, they degrade the important role of the government can play. So I think that we need to have a rethinking of our development theory and practice. And the World Bank is the one of the most important development institutions. It's a knowledge bank. I think we need to lead the discussion of the rethinking of the development in order to provide a better theoretical understanding and a policy recommendation to the developing country. And the World Bank certainly can also play a very important role to point to the importance of social protection, because no matter how good your policy is, some kind of shock will be there. And you always feel some kind of vulnerable group of people, poor people, they will be adversely affected. And the government can remind the government, the World Bank can remind the government to set up the social protection system and also give some funding to help with those kind of efforts. And the World Bank certainly can also have some kind of quick response. If it has some external shock, the World Bank, the country will increase their needs, and the World Bank can increase its effort. Just like in this time, during the financial crisis, the World Bank tripled its lending in the last year, and that proved to be helpful to some developing countries. So let me conclude. How to reduce the poverty? How to help the poor people to weather through the possible food crisis and economic crises in the future is still a very challenging job for people like us in the development fields. And based on the discussion, I'd like to mention, first one, since the poor will be always the most vulnerable, and the government has a very important function to play, to reduce the possibility of shock, and also to reduce the possible impact on them. The second one, for the food crisis, the government can reduce the variation in the production by better technology, better irrigation infrastructure, and increase the opportunity for people to increase their income. And the government can also keep some kind of reserve in order to prevent the price hike. And at a global level, it's important to promote free trade, including not only the manufactured product, but also agricultural grain. And also to have an international collective action, possibly to have some kind of global grain reserve, share reserve, or to have some kind of virtual stock. And for the economic crisis, the best way is to rely on both market and also government. For the market, so we can follow comparative advantages. For the state, so we can have a better, smooth upgrading and diversification, and to have a more dynamic growth. And by that, we can create more jobs for the poor people. We can make the economy more competitive, more resilient. And in this process, we can never forget there's always some people who are left behind. So we need to have a better social protection, social safety net. And both the national government and international organization that can make some contribution. For the World Bank, it's a bank, so it has some fund can use to support the technological innovation, improvement in irrigation and other infrastructure. But more importantly, compared to the needs, most important contribution should come from the knowledge part. For that, we need to have a better, we need to have a developing thinking which can really help the poor. And we also need to support free trade and global collective action. And regarding the knowledge, I think university like UC Davis can help a lot also. So I personally look forward to working with you in order to promote the right ideas and to help the poor, and hopefully we can have a world as we dream at the World Bank, a world free of poverty. Thank you.
So we can have some Q&A, right?
So we have some time for Q&A. We do not have a mic, so please maybe stand up and speak loudly if you have a question.
After the price hike in the international trade market in 2007-2008, some countries start to pursue a different route to maintain self-sufficiency in their food supply. They go to another country and rent cotton.
Yeah. And that's a very good question. You know, it has been debated, discussed in the international communities. First, certainly we hope this is a win-win situation for both the country provide investment and the country receive the investment. And we need to avoid the situation you just mentioned. You know, this kind of investment crowded out the opportunity for local people. And how to achieve that? I think it's very important to make the investment very transparent. And before the making investment, we need to, you know, have a clear definition of the right of the people to the land, and then allow the investment to come. During this investment process, it should be transparent. And if they can move in that direction, I think that the investment is likely to be a win-win situation. And let me add up. Not only transparent, we also need to have the monitoring. And in the monitoring process, the civil society can play a very important function. International organization can also play a very important function.
So my question is about the position of the World Bank as a research and lending institution. What do you think is the comparative advantage of the World Bank? And where is competition coming from?
Well, I think the World Bank has some competitive advantage in a sense. The researcher at the World Bank is more close to operation. Not only close to operation, can have access to operation in many, many countries. And we know that if a theory wanted to make a contribution, the theory should close to the economic phenomena where it occurred. And the World Bank has an opportunity to do that better than other research institutions. But other research institutions certainly also have some comparative advantages. Because by nature, we are close to operation, and it's very easy people looking into the short-term issue. And a research institution, like in the university, they can have more the so-called blue sky ideas. You know, it may not have a direct operational implication, but it may have a long-term impact in the future. So I think the important thing is that we need to increase our interaction to learn from each other. And more importantly, the goal is to help the poor people. And for our competitive advantages, I say that we have a much better access to the field. And for the university, is somewhat more limited compared to the World Bank. But the knowledge of the field can be shared. And I'd like to mention to you, last week, we have a very important policy changes. That is, World Bank now make all the data accessible, free, open, on the internet. It's a new policy. I say that, you know, when we announced the policy, in a press conference, I say it's a dream come true for me. Because before I joined the World Bank, I always questioned why the World Bank charged the use of data. Why the World Bank would not share all the information with, you know, academic researchers like myself. And now I see that happen. So it's a dream come true for me, and I hope it's also a dream come true for you. We don't want to have the competitive advantages. We hope you share the competitive advantages with someone. Okay. The lady here.
Welcome to UC Davis.
My pleasure.
As a 40-year resident of Davis, I say you'd like to extend a personal welcome to you. I used to be with the Asian Development Bank.
Yeah, I saw you there because you were the director, I remember.
I'm very delighted that the focus of the World Bank is poverty alleviation.
Right.
And I think one way to lift the millions of people out of poverty is in many ways through land reform, the right to use the land, so that they have some kind of collateral to do something with it. I witnessed how it is in China, for instance. Last year I was in Xi'an and going out to the poor areas, and I found this cornfield, just contiguous, 20 minutes by car, still the same field. And you can see the increase in productivity as a result of that, compared with 20 years ago, everyone would just have a tiny little piece. And because they have much more freedom in the use of the land, either you lease it out or you lease it in. Has the World Bank be doing in that particular area to assist the countries to allow the people, particularly the poor in the rural areas, to have the more freedom in the use of the land, particularly in the ownership of the land? Thank you.
I think the freedom to use of the land is very important. And certainly, the freedom to use of land, as long as you have a long, secure lease, you can do that. And that is the approach that China used. The limitation is that long, secure lease may not be used as collateral. and not related to access to finance issue. But we observe, in some cases, if you have a secure land right, and you can use the land as a collateral. But in some country, even they have the land right, but the bank may not be accept that as a collateral because the enforcement cost will be so high. But at the same time, you also need to look. In the U.S., farmers have a large piece of land. You know, to have hundreds of acres or thousands of acres. So those then use a collateral. You can borrow a lot of money from the bank, and you can do a lot of investment. But in a small land holding country like in China, even then, it's privately owned. And it can use it as a collateral. But we know that then value is very small, especially in the rural area. So use that, you know, the money they can borrow from the bank is still very small. But as to enforce the collateral right, if they cannot return the money and the bank want to take that land to have auction and so on, that cost will be too high for the bank. So under that kind of situation, even they have the proper property right, the bank may not accept that as collateral because of the high transaction cost. And we observe, we do have some research to show that, not in China, in other countries. So I think the fundamental issue you raise is access to credit. And what is a better way to access to credit? I think that a country in different situation may have to provide different solution. And to have a secure end right might be one way, but it may not be the only way or most effective way. So I'm, you know, I think that because I study institution, and I think many people here also study institution. I think a study institution, now we call the new institutional economics. From what I learned, there are two lessons. One, institution matters, so I follow your agreement. Different institutions may have different impact on the efficiency and so on. The other one, equally important, is institution is endogenous. And what is effective institution, it will be different from country to other country. And even with one country, one stage of development to the other stage of development. Okay.
My question is about some, you mentioned the knowledge bank of the position of the World Bank. And actually myself working in the alternative energy. And I think in my personal experience, I found that in the global knowledge system, I think the Western country, the developed country, has a dominant advantage.
Yeah.
And actually, on by the intellectual right, I think they grab this dominant advantage. And my personal experience tell me that it's very hard for us to have the cooperation on the technology. So my question is how the World Bank can help the developing country to specifically in a specific technology cooperation with the developed country.
Yeah, I think that you know, a lot of developing country, if you look in this stage of development, they can benefit a lot from mature technologies. And for the mature technology, there's no, you know, patent protection. For example, in the last few years, the apple in China, the quality improved a lot. And those apples use the Fuji apple, right? The ripe, very sweet apple. And that was a new variety developed in Japan 40, 50 years ago. And so now you can use that technology free. And this is just one example. In a lot of technology, developing country can benefit from that. But when a country move up the technological ladders, they will gradually move to the technological frontier. When they move to technological frontiers, then certainly you need to compare whether to pay pattern loyalty, it's cheaper were to reinvent the wheel, it's cheaper. And certainly you're fine to pay the pattern royalty will be cheaper than reinvent the wheel, right? And under the kind of situation, you know, to introduce property right protection would be desirable. But for a developing country to introduce those kind of property right protection would be favorable, because if a developing country, they follow the competitive advantage the path I advocate, very likely the country can turn from a low-income country to a middle-income country or even high-income country within one generation. That was the case in Korea. That was the case in Singapore, in Hong Kong. And so, because you need to prepare yourself to the higher stage of development. So for a developing country, on the one hand, you can use imitation and to get technological innovation, but if you grow so fast, you will reach a stage you need to protect property right in order to encourage indigenous R&D. So I think that we need to look into the both possibilities. And so for that, I do support the developing country to, on the one hand, follow their competitive advantages so they can benefit from the advantage of backwardness, but on the other hand, to increase their intellectual property rights protection. And so they can prepare themselves for a higher stage of development.
The competitive advantage, and you said monopoly is not advocated in this kind of kind of term.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering, so is there any situation that monopoly will have some positive effect on economic crisis? And if this kind of situation exists, how the government will play a role in it, and how
work
that would play a role in it?
Well, that's a good question, yeah. And in a way, in high-income country, the government intentionally to create a monopoly and to allow monopoly has a rate. That is the pattern system, right? Because for the high-income country, if they want to continuously upgrade their industry with technology, they are on the global frontier. They need to invent that by themselves. To do the invention, the cost of investment, trial and error, are very high. And also to provide incentive for the firm to enter into those kind of high-risky activity, they need to give them high return. But the issue is that any new technology, once you invent it, it's very easy to imitate. And so how to overcome those kind of asymmetry is to have a pattern system to give them monopoly for a certain period of time. And so monopoly is just like a price for successful invention. And the monopoly rent will give them incentive to engage in risky R&D activity. So that's one example. But that is consistent with the competitive advantage also. Because of high-income country, their competitive advantage is that they have a lot of capital. And they have the ability to invest in capital intensive type of activities. And also they have the ability to share the risk, to spread the risk. And so to enter into the R&D is also the competitive advantage of the high-income country.
Can you hear me? Yeah. I had a question about the global food reserve or food bank.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that's an idea that the World Bank is actively pursuing, and maybe you can tell us a little bit about how far along that is. But I had some questions. My first thought was you might call it the special drawing rights.
Yeah.
But aside from being a pun on the IMF, you know, the IMF's operation of their financial reserves has obviously been very controversial. Sometimes they gave out money that people thought they shouldn't have given out, and sometimes they didn't give out money that should have been given out.
Yeah.
So it strikes me that although it's a great idea, there are serious sovereignty and sort of operational problems. And in addition to that, for the IMF, they can just wire the money, yeah. but you can't really wire food. So going back to medieval times, we yeah. know that these stores would have to be placed on some territory yeah. with somebody's yeah. tanks and guns in front. I wonder how that would all work.
Theoretically, it's very easy to understand, right? Because if every household needs to be self-sufficient, then we are going to be extremely ineffective system. Supposedly, you are a professor, you also need to grow the grand wheel cell, produce enough grand wheel cell. And you can imagine what kind of system it will be. And so now we move to the national government to be responsible for grand reserve. And so you don't have to be self-sufficient, right? And also the market and the national grand reserve to prevent those kind of price hike. And Dan is here, and I understand that he did an article with my mentor, Gail Johnson, I think maybe 4 decades ago, to show that. To have a grand global grand reserve system will be much more efficient. But certainly the trouble, as you mentioned, political economy issue, you know, national government sovereignty issue emerge. But that's our job, right? We need to continue to advocate that. And now we are in a new era of multilateralism, and hopefully our knowledge, our wisdom will prevail. And so for this, certainly so far we don't have a plan to do that. But it does not mean that we should not advocate that. And so in the World Bank, in IPRI, and I'm sure many faculty members here also have the idea. If we can join hands to make this a loud voice and to convince the politician, then we may come to an agreement. Just like free trade. Well, in the past, it may not be so easy for people to understand, especially in a global downturn like this, you have high unemployment domestically. And so in 1929, When they saw high unemployment domestically, immediate reaction is to reduce import in order to protect jobs domestically. But if you protect your domestic job, the other country reduce their export. So their unemployment shoot up. When their unemployment increased, they have less ability to buy your product. As a result, everyone's unemployment increased, right? And now this time, how come? With such a large shock, immediately in G20, the first meeting, they already agreed to have a free trade. And hopefully, that we learn from the lesson, we learn from the analysis. And I'm sure, I hope that people also learn. And so that's my job, that's also your job, and also everyone here's job, to promote this kind of ideas, to have a global grand reserve that will be much more efficient for everyone, that will be pro-poor, that will reduce the vulnerability of the poor. That's good for everyone. And if that has become a common knowledge, I think a politician will follow it. Okay. Well, okay.
I'm quite interested in the Chinese currency route valuation.
Yeah.
And do you think this revaluation will do effect to the world economy crisis? And do you think it's better for China to do the revaluation step by step with a decade and or just to do the evaluation like some jumps? Thank you.
Well, that's a pretty, you know, that's a very political charged question. Let me be good politician. First, that for a rapid growing economy, the real exchange rate will appreciate. Because if you have a rapid growing economy, your wage rate will increase. And both trade sector and the non-trade sector, wage rate will increase. And under that kind of situation, your real wage rate will increase. But increase in the real real exchange rate does not necessarily mean you need to appreciate your nominal exchange rate. That's two things. And that is a long-term trend. And for the current situation, from what I see, the main challenges for the global economy is excess capacities that exist in high-income countries and also in many other parts of the world. And so for this kind of exchange rate issue, I think that we should not be emotional, we should be rational, and to look carefully whether the appreciation of Chinese currency will help the U.S. to solve the unemployment issue and to really help China to reduce the trade surplus. I think that is an bigger issue. And so far, I would say most of the discussion did not substantiate by very careful empirical analysis. So I would encourage you not to jump to a conclusion, but to a much better empirical research about its likely impact on the employment in the US and also on the trade surplus in China.
I was with Professor Hai Wen last week in Shenzhen. I work at the Institute of Transportation Studies. We have signed agreement with the Shenzhen campus. We will have two joint centers over there.
Yeah.
I also worked at the World Bank at the beginning, early 1990s.
Yeah.
I think when Larry Summers was the chief economist.
Okay.
My question is basically, in light of the recent crisis, what do you think about the economic theories of the Chicago School?
That's a very good question and a very valid question. Actually, I asked that question when I returned to China in 1987. And, because in 1987, I like to say I was the first one to return to China with a PhD degree in economics from abroad. But not only in economics, I was the first one to return to China with a PhD degree in social sciences. And so before I went back to China, actually many professors and so on said you should not go back because you could not make a contribution. China was a social country, planning economy, and you were trained in Chicago, how could you make a contribution? Then I think that, what I learned from Chicago, my understanding is that, I was lucky to be able to be mentored by master like, Dieter Schwartz, Gail Johnson, and Gary Bakers, and a lot of Nobel Prize winners at that time. And I observed, what really I learned from them is the approach. The approach to observe the real world phenomena, to understand the mechanism behind that phenomena. So-called mechanism behind that phenomena was to understand who made the decision. Who, when he or she made the decision, choice. What kind of constraint the person faced, and what kind of opportunity option the person has. And among the constraint and options, how the person made the choice, and the result is the phenomenon that this theory tried to explain. And that's how, I think that's the most valuable part of my learning in Chicago. And I think that if I carry those kind of approach back to China, it should be very useful. If I carry the theory back to China, then it won't be useful because the phenomena in China sometimes may appear to be the same. China certainly can have inflation, China can have deflation, China can have misallocation of resources. But the reason behind that may be different, right? So if I wanted to use that theory directly applied to China, then it won't be helpful. But if I use this approach, then it's very helpful. And because every country faces certain kind of constraint, and they have some kind of options. And among all the options, which one is the best? Those kind of constraint, optimization is very useful. So when you look, say, you know, the reflection of the Chicago School, if you say it's a theory, then certainly it may not applicable. But just like theory in any other school. But if you say it's an approach, then I think it's very useful, even today.
Thank you, Justin. That was a great answer. And I think that's a perfect note to end our seminar on. Our time is up. Please join me in thanking our distinguished guests.